and welcome to MEM's webinar, Eyes on the Scene, Strategies to Improve Incident Investigation and Outcomes. My name is Terry Sweeten. I'm a field service manager with Missouri Employers Mutual, and my position is kind of a unique insurance position. There are three of us located throughout the state. We kind of split the state territory, and our position includes on-site investigations, training, education. Pre-COVID, we did a lot of on-site and training and education. Post-COVID, we're doing the webinars. So again, welcome to MEM's webinar. We're going to have a lot of information to go over today. We're doing incident investigations and claim outcomes, and there's some new case law out there that we're kind of excited about to share with you today. The chat function is being monitored, and we're going to stop for questions in the middle and the end so we can kind of keep the presentation rolling throughout and be very cognizant of your time. I know we're taking your time during lunch, and we appreciate that, but we're going to keep it moving, keep it rolling, and if you have questions, just ask them, and we'll get those answered. The contact information is at the end of the presentation. We're here to help. There's several of us online, so if you need something either during this presentation or after, please get hold of us. We'll be glad to help you any way we can. Some of the session takeaways that we're going to have today are why time matters in an investigation and understanding the crucial claim components, review the key steps in the investigation process, and review case law in support of performing thorough and timely investigations. Step one on any claim or accident investigation is to prevent a claim, and you don't need the rest of this presentation. We enjoy having you here today, but if you're not having claims and you're not having issues, we salute you. But if you can prevent the claim, if you can look for safety concerns, if you can fix those concerns when they show up, if you have employer management involvement now, it'll prevent a claim in the future. So eventually you're going to see it one way or another, either now or later. I really encourage you to utilize MEM Safety and Risk Services. We have a team of great individuals out in the field that can help you from a safety standpoint, and the field service managers are available as a resource always to help you too. You know, talk safety, be an example of safety, and look for safety concerns. I go out to do an awful lot of investigations, and I find out that someone was seriously injured, but multiple people have been injured before that. Just the safety issue wasn't corrected, and so someone finally ended up having a serious injury. The last one's pretty hard to do in this current environment, but hire the right people to do the job. Don't hire your next work comp claim. At MEM, we see about 50% of our the individuals that are injured are new hires within the last year. That's a pretty high number for us. Step two, you got an accident and management program in place. So what you want to do is you, for first of all and foremost, take care of your employee and show concern for that employee. Direct the initial medical care. That is your right under the Missouri Work Comp law. It's a huge benefit is to direct that medical care versus letting someone else direct that medical care. Avoid emergency room care unless it's true emergency. You know, if it's a true emergency, then use emergency room. Those services will be covered. But if not, that's about the most expensive medical care you can get. Timely report the claim. Without a claim reported, you don't get the assistance of your insurance company. So get those claims reported, get them in. We're going to talk a little bit about statute of limitations in a minute and some of the reasons why that's important. Have a backup plan for after hours injuries. Those are where we see most injuries kind of go hazard outside of what we would like them to be. And it's because they didn't have an after hours plan. Did drugs and alcohol play a role? You know, request a drug and alcohol test. That was discussed a lot in the last presentation, but we're going to talk about it again today. Plan for light duty restrictions and advise the medical provider. That is very, very important. Again, that was discussed a lot, but if you don't have a light duty program, you don't bring them back to work, you're going to have indemnity claims. Those in the long run are going to cost you a lot more money than a med only or report only claim. Written documentation on who, what, when, where, why, and how. Look for pre-existing injuries. Consider having someone attend the appointment with the injured employee. That way you know what's going on. That employee is kind of stressed. They may not be thinking as openly as they normally would. So if you have someone attend, that helps that employee. And is there a safety violation? Did they do something they weren't supposed to be doing? Again, keep that communication ongoing. That is the most important thing you can do. I'm going to talk about a lot of case law today. So there's some good case law out there. This is one is Kent versus NCH Healthcare, February 2021. And the Missouri Court of Appeals ruled the employer was not responsible for unauthorized medical. So we've got a Missouri Court of Appeals law out there. And what 297.140.1 says is if the employee desires, he shall have the right to select his own physician, surgeon, or other requirement at his own expense. And this case law supports that. In this case, the employee was terminated from employment and they sought care without making a demand on the employer. So if you have a demand or if you know that something's going on, if you deny the medical or you don't respond, then you could be responsible for paying that medical. But if you stand on, I have the right to direct that medical care, give them an option on medical care, and they choose not to, they would be able to pay it at their own expense. Step three is an accident investigation. So what we have to have something that's written and enforced accident investigation procedures in place, ready to go before you have an accident. Have an accident reporting policy in place. And MEM has a sample, it's on our website. And you need to make sure all employees know who to report to, when it's required to report, the employees seeking care of their own expense. That needs to be posted. And in my world, if it's signed, that means they are understanding that information. Include written forms. So go to mem-ins.com for examples. We've got all the written supervisor forms, incident investigation forms, they're all out there. And again, if you have a signature, that means that it has been identified and verified, and we can use that in support if we need to on an accident investigation at a later date. Require all your supervisors and your managers to participate and understand the value of your accident investigation. And that's really important because if one supervisor says go do something different than what your plan is, then you're probably still responsible for that. I'm going to tell people to stop and investigate. That is hard to do. We have busy lives. We have a lot of things going on a regular basis, but it is so important to stop and investigate, and that makes the outcome and the difference in these claims. Accident investigation procedures, again, written process to handle before an accident. Train your staff on how to manage a work comp claim once it occurs. Take photos, videos, statement, receipts, anything that you can get to keep as a record and keep that information for any future use. Process the document findings. You have somewhere that you're holding them, you're keeping them a record. A lot of accounts keep a work comp claim and a personnel file separate, just so that you have those documents somewhere where you can readily get hold of them if you need them in the future. Communicate with the physician, the insurance staff, the agents, you know, keep that communication rolling so that you know what's going on those claims from the very beginning all the way to the end of the claim. Was the employee qualified to perform the task? Look at that part as your accident investigation. If, again, that goes back to those new hires, if they're not qualified to perform the task and they're injured, that's something that needs to change so that we don't have future claims. Assess all the accidents, you know, what went right and then what went wrong. It's okay to say something went wrong and fix it. You know, what is notice? And we always talk about this because I hear a lot of times when I go out on accident scenes, I hear employers say, well, they didn't tell me they had a work comp claim. But when you find out, you talk to the supervisor, yes, the supervisor was aware of it. So that is notice. So if someone saw the accident, told by another employee, the supervisor is aware of it, and where the employee sought medical care, that is a notice too. Heard about the accident, received a text message. I'm getting lots and lots of ways that we get messages now through text messages, and we can keep track of those. If you saw it on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, or Snapchat, those are all ways that say that you as an employer may have had notice. Statute of limitations, we kind of bring this up because it is 2 years from the date of injury or last benefit paid if the claim is reported. If the claim is not reported, then the statute extends to 3 years. You need to report it as a report only to limit the statute. It doesn't, in our case, we open it, we send a division of work comp, we close it, nothing goes against your experience mod, nothing counts against you, but it is a record, and then that means in 2 years that claim would close. There is some ability to have fines for late reporting, not really seeing that through the division yet, but that is always out there and a possibility. Claims do get reported at 1,090 days. So just letting you know, those are really hard to investigate at a later date because there's so much time has gone by and trying to pick up the pieces is really difficult. So photos, this is one thing that is kind of near and dear to the FSM's heart, and that we take a lot of photos of accident scenes. We want photos of the entire scene. We want photos up close and far away. We like photos of the vehicles, machinery involved. So if there's a machine that has malfunctioned, we need the VIN numbers, the make and model, the titles, the bills of sale, whatever we can find to identify that vehicle, because we can go back from a subrogation standpoint and look and see if there's been recalls or anything on that machinery or that vehicle. Take photos of the people involved, take photos of the injuries if it's applicable. You know, look for contributing factors. Is there machinery, roads, skid marks, weather? What contributed to that accident, and get photos of it? Here's a photo of an accident that I did not too long ago, and it's really kind of hard to tell when you're up close what the vehicle looks like. That it tells a picture, it tells a story, but we can't see up close. Now in this one, there is a story, and that if you notice that it is a pretty serious accident, and both employees did live from this, so you know, it wasn't a fatality claim. But if you notice, there is a seatbelt on the ground there. And what that tells us when we go in and do an accident investigation is that seatbelt was cut off of that individual. So that individual did have a seatbelt on. But when you look at this picture, you see it a little farther away. You see where the impact of the vehicle was at. You actually see what type of vehicle. You see what was in the back of the vehicle at that point in time. You can zoom in, you can zoom out. And trying to get those pictures just kind of shows you in a distance and up close what you need to see so that you can look at it in the future if you need it. Video, the power of video is so amazing. You know, it provides your weather conditions, your distance, your guides, how far out something was, what is around it as far as businesses, things like that. And video preserves the scene and how it looked at the time of the accident. And that's really important, because that's what you're going to go back and look at. And some of these claims take a while to close. So you may be looking at this, you know, a year or two down the road. But when you're looking at video and when you're looking at accidents, what businesses and homes are around, you would be surprised how often you're on video just in your day, everyday life and moving around. So can you look at those businesses, look at those homes? Possibly there were other vehicles that had video now in them, so that you could look at that too and gather all of that information. The reason why this needs to be done in such a quick and timely manner is it's a lot of the video is only there for a short time. It copies over itself, and so it's not available very long. And people move on. So once they move on and have something else on the video, it may not be there anymore. A lot of times I hear people say, well, I can't copy the video, I don't know how. And so you can copy it with your phone or a thumb drive. Simply just take a video of the video with your phone. Identify where the video was taken or obtained, and then show date, time, and length of video if possible. We always like video if it's possible to have it. I wanted to put this one in there. This is a case scenario. I call it go jump in the lake. And the employee was working alone in construction down around the lake area and decided to go fishing for a little while. The employee dropped his pole in the water. He jumped in to save the fishing pole. And then he left for a little bit. So we're assuming he left to go change and dry off. He did have an active workers' compensation claim ongoing, and the employee denied that the incident ever happened to the employer. So here we see it. We smile for the camera. And in this case, the homeowner actually had a lot of video that showed this individual, what he was doing, the length of time he was doing it, things along that line. And so in these cases, not only does it help from a work comp standpoint, but it may help in an employment type of a situation also. So slip, trip, and falls, we do a lot of investigation on slip, trip, and falls. You're going to see in just a minute on the case histories that we're having, that why you really need to do an investigation. Plus, that's kind of the number one way we're seeing people right now have injuries. So what we're going to look on slip, trips, and falls investigation is what type of shoes was someone wearing? Where was the fall? On stairs, parking lot? Was the employee carrying anything? How heavy in size was the object being carried? And right now, that's really important, is if somebody was carrying something, what was the size and how heavy it was? So that may require an investigation for somebody to actually weigh what they're carrying. You know, looking at the weather condition, any contributing factors. And again, slip, trip, and fall, we're seeing an awful lot of those claims right now. Here's a case example. The employee tripped but did not fall. The accident happened at 5:30 p.m. The employee went to the emergency room. The employer did not direct medical care. They had a previous back surgery, a recent new hire, and the claim was reported late. So do we pay the bills? Yes or no? The answer is yes. The employer did not direct to the ER, so ER care was covered. The employer was aware the injury happened at the time. There was no accident investigation performed. It was late reported, so the ER treatment was received before MEM could even assist. So we can't help with the treatment, help triage, anything along that line, because it was already done. The employee was hired with a previous back surgery, and the employee was not advised of an accident reporting policy or procedure when they were hired. So there was no record that the employee knew what their procedure was when they were injured and on the job. And in this case, a second opinion is warranted in this one. Communication, what you don't say is just as important as what you do say. So no response is not direction. If we don't give a response, if you don't direct exactly where you want someone to go and advise them if they need medical treatment later, more than likely that would be covered under the work comp law. Prevailing factor is a term you're going to hear a lot in workers' comp, and the law states an injury must be the prevailing factor. So what does that mean? That defines it as the primary factor in relation to any other factor causing both the resulting medical condition and disability. So I hear a lot of times people say, well, I was at work, it's work-related. Just being at work does not make something work-related. There's new case law that makes an investigation more important now, and due diligence in an investigation and taking the time, again, to stop and investigate may make a difference in the outcome. Going and coming, this is something that we talk about a lot. We've seen a lot of this recently, and driving to and from work is normally not considered compensable under the work comp law. So employees traveling from their home to their principal place of business, that would not be covered, even if they're traveling in a company vehicle. What makes going and coming work-related would be if they are doing a special benefit for an employer. So you've asked them to stop on their way from home to a warehouse and pick something up. From the time they hit the warehouse to the time that they get to their office, they're probably covered under work comp. The special errand, if you ask them to go out and do the mail or get donuts or something along that line, that could be considered a work-related travel. And the driver may be covered from the home to first stop, just depends on where that principal place of business is. Here's kind of a case example that's out there right now. The nurse was injured in a motor vehicle accident, traveling from their personal home to the client's house. Mileage was only paid between the clients and not to the first appointment. So between clients from point B to C was covered, but not from A to B to get there. Wages were not paid until the first appointment, and they were driving their personal vehicle, which really does or doesn't make any difference. And the client called to inform the nurse did not make it to the appointment. And that's kind of important. This isn't a Missouri employee, so you want to keep in mind that every law is a little bit different for each one of the individual states. It is a denied claim. It was considered going and coming rule. The wages were not paid on mileage until the first appointment. So they had to get to the first appointment, then their wages and their mileage started. And the laws, again, are different in different states, but the accident investigation performed indicating didn't make it to the client's home. So they knew that she had not made it to the first stop yet. And want to be consistent. You want to make sure that you're consistent with your employees across the board. Another one that we look at is deviation of route. And this is one of those things in the work comp law that I think is probably underutilized, and I'm not exactly sure why, but if an employee is traveling away from their premises as part of their duties, they're probably covered. But if they do something from a personal errand, they may no longer be covered. And so what we look at is it's not really related to the time or the distance traveled. It's a more focused on the investigation and the purpose being served. So at the time, were they doing something employment related when they were in the accident and injured, or were they doing something that was exclusively personal in nature? And that's really big, because typically the insurance person is not going to know exactly what they were doing unless they're told by the employer, because you're going to know where you sent them and where they were supposed to be. You're also going to know where your job sites are. So has the employee's employment related journey terminated? So if they're no longer doing something for you, did that terminate? And if so, when? Ask where and what the employee was at and where they were doing when they were injured. use Google Earth, maps, known routes. Google Earth can show you just about anything now. But I can tell you, if you can get us the information, our adjusters can make that determination too. They just need to know where they're supposed to be going. Employee comfort does come into play. So you do have to let the employee take breaks on a regular basis, get something to eat, stop for comfort, things along that line. So they would still be covered if that. But how does the employer benefit is what you're looking at on deviation of route. And this is what we always talk about on deviation of route. A to B is probably covered. You're sending them from point A to point B. They're compensable. If they stop for soda or food, that would be considered compensable. But if they're from point B to C or C to A, they're more likely they're doing something that is related more in personal nature than actual work related. This again is one of the areas I think we kind of probably don't hit as often because I'm not sure that everyone knows that's out there and available through the work comp law. Drug and alcohol investigations, you know, written and enforced drug and alcohol policy. Don't discriminate across the board. Look at testing, potential to reduce the work comp claim and death benefits by 50%. You know, and this again is one of those things you really need to investigate when you have an injury because you have to be due testing per the work comp law within 24 hours. I always tell people to encourage testing beyond 24 hours because you don't want someone to report a claim at 25 hours because they don't want to be drug tested. But it's also a total denial if it's the cause of the accident or the work comp law, and a total forfeiture of a work comp claim if they refuse to take a drug and alcohol test. If you can, have it put in writing. If not, I'll show you here in a minute some other ideas, but could be a total forfeiture, and we have seen those under the work comp law. So employers should set up an appointment if you can. Tell them when the date and time. Let's hope it's in writing. You know, watch for Friday afternoon claims, because if you get up Friday afternoon and you wait until Monday morning, you've missed that penalty opportunity. Must be the influence at the time of the accident. And the I always have to put this on here, the employer should not provide the alcohol or drugs. If an employee refuses to drug test, don't argue with them. Set up an appointment, see if they show up, advise them of the date and time, and save any text messages you might have back and forth. That's what we're seeing as a lot of evidence recently is text messages, and get them to sign their refusal if they will, and get your HR involved very quickly. Motor vehicle accident investigation, name and contact of information for all parties involved, dates and times, make models of vehicles. The number one way to die in work-related accident in the state of Missouri right now is motor vehicle accidents. So we see an awful lot of these out there. I know the FSMs do a lot of accident investigations. So if you can, have a motor vehicle packet in the vehicle so that they know what their procedures are, provide a checklist. You know, people are hurt, they're injured, they're nervous, they're upset. They need kind of something that is easy to understand and follow. You know, train your staff on your accident protocols. And I used to think providing a disposable camera maybe wasn't really necessary, but I've had some situations where they have had a vehicle accident and their phone was somewhere that they can't find in the car. So they normally can get to the glove box where the disposable camera is. Maybe their phone has been damaged, things along that line. So consider videos. If that driver's at fault, consider driver training. MEM provides motor vehicle training, and there's a lot of ways out there. Let's get them some new training if they're at fault. And look at subrogation if applicable. We have a good subrogation department at MEM, and we'll go out there and look to see if someone else is at fault. How do we actually recover for that claim? Equal exposure doctrine under Missouri law requires equal exposure. So if an injury comes from a hazard or risk unrelated to the employment to which a worker would have equally been exposed outside of and unrelated to the employment in normal non-employment life. So that says a whole lot in one paragraph. And what it really means is, do you have equal exposure while working as you would when you're not working? And in this case, an employee choked on a breakfast sandwich while driving, and they were driving from point A to point B, so they choked on a sandwich. The Industrial Commission denied the claim and said they were not at any greater risk, than there was equal exposure to have done this while eating on personal business as work business. The Missouri Court of Appeals reversed and said it was compensable. And right now, the Missouri Supreme Court has agreed to hear the case. Now, the Missouri Supreme Court normally doesn't agree to hear a case unless they think there's some measure in something that was done through the Missouri Court of Appeals. So this one's really interesting. I'm curious to see how this turns out. Subcontractors, we're seeing a lot of uninsured subcontractors across the state. And 287.040 basically says it covers work comp contractors and subcontractors. And it says immediate subcontractor is liable. Now, if that immediate subcontractor doesn't have insurance, then it secondarily goes up until we find somebody that does. So what we're looking at right now is a lot of uninsured subcontractors that the general contractors are being found responsible for the work comp claim. It's in the law. It's the requirement. You can't get around it. They are very difficult claims to manage because there's really nobody in control of that individual. They don't really work for that employer, but that's the law. So in construction, if you have one or more employees, you're required by law to have work comp insurance, and there's penalties, jail times, things like that associated if employers don't. So you must obtain up-to-date and regular certificates of insurance to guarantee that your people have insurance that are working for you. Employee or an independent contractor, and we get this a lot. We get this individual is an independent contractor. And the main factor that determines if they are an employee or an independent contractor is control. Keys the amount of control exercised by the alleged employer. So how often do they work for you? Do you tell them when to come to work and when not to come to work? Can you discharge? Can you fire and hire that individual? How do you pay them? What's your payment method? A degree alleged employer furnishes equipment. So are you providing all the equipment and all of the furnishings that individual needs to do their job? Extent than the regular business of the employer. So are they doing something that you normally would be doing? And another thing that looks at control is your employment contract. We have a case example where an individual was cutting a board with a table saw, cut the tips of their fingers off. This individual happened to be a minor. The employer stated not an employee. They said they're an independent contractor. They were hired on the spot, paid weekly by a check. The employer had control of the employee. It was 2 months late reported claim, and there was no guide on the saw, no safety cut off, no shield, blade was dull, those type of things. So is this one compensable or not? The answer is absolutely compensable. There was no other employment. They were performing work only for that employer. They were paid for a check for 40 hours a week, and that was on the employer's letterhead on their check. Surgery was performed, returned to work next day, which was amazing because they did offer light duty return to work. So there was some control there to get that person back to work even after a surgery. The employee had worked 4 to 5 months prior to the injury, and their employer penalty for lack of guarding. There is a penalty under the Missouri law where it actually adds on to the cost of the claim if the employer doesn't follow safety rules. And again, in things to keep really in mind in this is miners cannot operate dangerous equipment. So if you're going to have people operating equipment, hopefully they're not miners, but make sure they are trained to operate that equipment and that equipment is in good working order. Attorney involvement, Missouri law, the attorney receives 25% of the settlement or weekly benefits if that's agreed to, and fees. There is a rate chart for permanent disability we'll look at here in a minute. No contact with the employee from the insurance company if represented, but the employer-employee relationship still exists. So that's where I always tell people, still communicate with your employee about their work comp claim. Talk to them, find out what's going on. One thing we're seeing right now is Form 21s coming in. And what that is the opposing counsel's notice of compensation that is posted with the Division of Work Comp. It's very important that we get those Form 21s in because there's a time limit of 30 days to answer that Form 21. If we do not answer that Form 21 within 30 days, then we admit every allegation as stated by that employee. And you don't want to do that because sometimes the wages are overstated, the injury is maybe questionable. We have to get those Form 21s in. So that's going to be talked about a little bit more on the next presentation that we have, and we'll show the Form 21s. But if you get any notice from an attorney on a claim, make sure you get it to your insurance company quickly. I always tell employers to try the system first. It is there to help them through the process without an attorney, and if they can get through that process, that's great. One thing we're seeing right now is delay in settling claims and closing claims because if an employee has an attorney, it has taken about 4 to 5 months for the plaintiff attorneys to get in a rating report or an IME report for their employee, it's like 4 to 5 months to get an appointment and 4 to 6 months to get a report. So we're seeing that delay that's almost over a year just because it's taking that long for the plaintiffs to get to the physicians that they want to use. Here's the rate chart. It's very easy under the work comp. It's so much per body part, and it's all worked out. That is something that's available, and some of my employers actually keep the rate chart for the employees so they can explain that process to them. Safety rules, failure to use safety device can reduce by 25 to 50%. You need to have a detailed list of safety rules readily available. And it's great to have a safety manual, but what I wanna see is rules that are easily, that you can post them, you can train with them if somebody's not following those rules. You know, maybe a one-page task by specific to the rules that involved in one accident or injury thing, tasks that you would do type of thing. It can be readily found and training provided. You know, make sure there's horseplay is not allowed or encouraged in your facility, and investigate where company procedures are being followed. If you have something on safety rules that is easy to understand and to manage, people will follow those. Time does matter. Complete the accident investigations within the first 48 hours. Continue investigation beyond 48 hours when needed. Oftentimes that's going to occur, but people forget. Scenes change, people talk to other people. You know, we have people that go home and their mother, their father, their uncle tell them to do something and get an attorney. And so things really change, the story changes, especially by time the insurance company can talk to them, because we may have a couple days in there before we get a chance to have a conversation. You know, secure statements in writing, since legal issues can take time. Video does disappear, it writes off, it goes away. Physical conditions changed rapidly. You know, don't leave it to your insurance carrier to do the investigation. Make sure you get that initial investigation done and secure that evidence. Cases have been won and lost based on accident investigations. Here's a time for questions. Did we have any chat? I haven't been watching, so I apologize, Flint, if there's something out there.
Terry, we did have a couple come in. If you can hear me, can you hear me all right, Terry?
I can.
If an employee refuses medical care, does there need to be a form that they sign for that? It's like something in writing.
Yes, MEM has a declination of medical treatment form, and it is on our website at mem-ins.com. Have them sign that form, and they can always go back and seek more medical treatment at a later date, but you wanna make sure that they're signing something now so that if they go out to the emergency room tonight, seek unauthorized care that they're not supposed to, that form will protect you. So it's called the Declination of Medical Treatment Form, and it is on our website.
And we have that, and if anybody needs that, email Terry or I. I'll put my email in the chat function if anybody needs that. We'll send that right out to you. Also, another question, Terry, for you. Should the claim be made as a report only if the employee does not want anything?
Yes. Securing that report only means that you stop that statute of limitations. So you're securing a statute of limitations for 2 years versus three. So yes, go ahead and report that claim as a report only. Doesn't count against you, doesn't go against your EMOD, but you will stop that statute of limitations. And if the division at some point does start fining for late reporting, you got it in. It's in timely. And if you ever want to change it, the employee changes their mind, they want care or they want treatment, it just call in and change that claim. It's very easy to do.
Very good. And I've got a couple of more just comments here. We have a sample incident reporting policy on the website, mem-ins.com. We can email that out to everybody as well. And we don't have a sample deviation of route policy, but I think that's really important when you mention that. For anybody with fleet drivers or folks that drive around to do their job, an out of route policy or deviation of route policy is super important.
Right, we don't have anything at this point.
At this point, we don't have one, but if you email Terry or I, we might be able to help you kind of figure out how that needs to be worded. And then if you were to make one up, and then also your comment, Terry, on safety rules, everybody that's attending our webinar today needs to have safety rules in place that actually address your top exposures, your top types of incident. And those are your strain, sprain, orthopedic incidents, your slip, trip, fall, working with machinery. If you have lockout, tag out, or machine guards, saws, that kind of things, those are top issues, safety issues. but also fleet. We have got to have more seatbelt policies in place and more distracted driving policies. So appreciate your comments on that, Terry, and just trying to reinforce those for you. So
great. All right, now we're gonna talk about our law updates, which is gonna be kind of exciting. And like I said, it has been a while since we've really had very good law updates, but some of these just happened in June of 2021. So this one is Jamie Overstreet versus Tamco Building. It's just decided June 8th, 2021, and it says basically no greater risk. So what this one says is the claimant alleged an injury to the knee from twisting while turning. And we see a lot of these kind of claims. Level surface, which is very important. We need to do that accident investigation, find out, are they on a level surface? Were they climbing stairs? Were they in the mud? What actually was the area around the area when they were injured and twisted their knee? The commission ruled the claimant failed to demonstrate a hazard would not have equally encountered outside of work. So if you've got a level area and you twist in your knee, you could do that at home, you could do that at Walmart, you could do that anywhere. So they said that basically that he didn't demonstrate his hazard. They failed to establish a work-related risk arising out of employment, and the claimant then came back on this claim, which was very interesting, and alleged uneven surface. So then they said, well, the surface really was uneven. Again, that if you'd had a good accident investigation at that point, you could show exactly what the surface was at the time of the injury. But the commission prevailed and said, no, this did not rise out of a course of employment, no greater risk than you would have had doing anything else. So walking over uneven surfaces in daily life, including public parking lots while shopping, is what they said. So the commission actually put this in writing. And your greater defense is falls on stairs, injuries occurring while getting in and out of vehicles, injuries from carrying routine items, carrying items with little or no weight. So there for a little while, someone would say, I had a piece of paper in my hand, and some of the cases were compensable because they were actually carrying something. Now we're looking at what kind of weight do they have? What were they carrying? Was it a bulky object? Those kind of things. So one thing that's really important too is have a job description developed and readily available. So everybody ought to have a job description that says, what do they do? How do they do it? And our claim reps are asking for a lot of job descriptions on a regular basis. Here's another law update. It was Sydney Durr versus AmeriCare Systems. It was decided just a week later, so June 16th of 2021. A CNA twisted their knee while wearing non-skid shoes, took a step backward in a tight space while rushing. She was handing out the meds and was kind of in a hurry, trying to get everything done early in the morning. The ALJ actually awarded benefits and said, yes, this would be a compensable claim. You twisted while you were doing something in your employment. The commission reversed it. And this is kind of big. So the commission reversed. The claimant failed to provide injury, rose out in the course of employment. There was no substance on the floor, not carrying anything, no lighting issues. And in this case, they did do a really good accident investigation and showed exactly where that individual was. So it can make a difference. Law update, Marks versus Missouri Department of Corrections. This is one that's been around for a little while. It's kind of an interesting one. It's April of 2020. And this individual basically worked for the Department of Corrections and went up and down stairs on a regular basis, on an hourly basis, checking for security reasons. They misstepped and they felt their right knee twist. They weren't responding to a code or an emergency, not distracted, not carrying anything, nothing on the floor, nothing along that line. There was nothing wrong with the steps. And that is something we do a lot of accident investigations on, is looking at steps. And it's amazing how many different steps there are, but nothing wrong with the steps. And the court held going up and down steps is a hazard equally exposed to in normal non-employment life. So you can go up downstairs to get in your home. You can go up and downstairs to get to a restaurant, things along that line. Next law update is Schoen versus Midmo Mental Health. That was April of 2020. And the claimant received an evaluation and treatment when they were treating for a work-related injury. The physician accidentally tripped the employee. So the employee went to the physician treatment for a work-related injury. The physician accidentally tripped them. They had additional injuries as a result of that trip. And the ALJ awarded benefits for the original injury and the additional injury. So they said both at that point in time. The commission reversed the decision and the Supreme Court agreed. So again, we're up all the way to the Supreme Court on this one and said, basically the original work comp claim is covered. what happened after that is not covered. So the employee asserted a simple but for cause, which means I wouldn't have been there if it hadn't been for my work-related injury. But the Supreme Court agreed that it was not a work-related injury. So accident must be a prevailing factor. And in this case, the original accident was not a prevailing factor in that employee being tripped at a later point, at a later date. So not enough that the employee is doing something related to or incidental work to make it work-related. I did include some Arkansas law in here. I'm actually going to have some Illinois law, which is kind of exciting. But Arkansas law is Pratt versus Landers, McCarty, Bentonville. And the employee crossed through a culvert on the way to work, fell, injured knee and back. The manager advised not supposed to be walking up the culvert. There was a clear path in another area that they were supposed to be walking in. And the dealership actually had a rule that no employees were to use the culvert area. And the employee was written up for violating that rule previously. And it was actually brought up in a sales meeting that we don't want our employees doing this culvert, walking across this culvert. We've got it in writing. We're going to write people up. And so when this individual got injured, the ALJ said not compensable. You're not performing job duties at the time of the injury. And the Arkansas Commission affirmed. So again, you know, that seems kind of simple. How do I tell my employee where to walk? But if you've got an area you don't want them walking in, you need to record it. You need to make sure they're aware of it. Again, if you can put it in writing to an employee, that makes or breaks your case. Here's an Illinois law update, and we don't get a lot of Illinois law updates sometimes that are favorable to employer, but this was Emily Purcell versus IWCC. She hopped over a chain barrier fence. The heel of her shoe got caught and injured her, and got caught when she injured her shoulder. So there's no defect with the fence. The grounds were fine. There was other clear walkways, and it was found not to be compensable, even under Illinois law. And it said basically she voluntarily hopped over a fence, and she created a higher danger to herself than she would have if she had followed the normal path. And as a result, it was really her benefit for a shorter path, not the employer's. So that was denied. One thing I hear a lot is fraud, the word fraud used quite a bit in work comp claims. And a definition of a fraud versus abuse is a little bit different. So what we're looking at, definition of abuse, is any practice that uses the workers' compensation system in a way that's contrary to either the intended purpose of the system or the statute. So example, employee doesn't go to appointments, they're working outside of their restrictions, or exaggerating an injury, maybe they're staying off work longer than they're supposed to be. It can be costly, but it's not really considered a fraud. It's more of an abuse of the system. One thing that I hear all the time is I don't have light duty available, and that employee is going out and doing activities that I don't think they should be doing. Well, if they can't come to work because you don't have a light duty policy, they're going to be a lost time claim. That's going to cost you more from your experience mod. It's going to cost more on that claim. But if they're doing an activity that is within the restrictions that the physician gave them, then there's no fraud under the work comp system. So again, get them back to light duty. You've got them working there. There's no question whether or not they can or can't be doing something. Now fraud, we do see fraud, and we do have a fraud non-compliance unit at Missouri Employers Mutual. And any person knowingly makes or causes to be made any false or fraudulent material statement or misrepresentation, so a lie, with intent that is material to obtain a benefit. So in order to be fraud, you have to have a lie, the intent, the material, and they're looking for a benefit. And Missouri fraud falls under the Missouri statute of 287-128. It's investigated by the Missouri Department of Labor Fraud Noncompliance Unit, called the FNU. And we, as an insurance company, cannot prosecute. We do have to go through the FNU to try to get them to prosecute, and they determine if there's prosecution or not. MEM continues to be the carrier that reports more claims than anybody else, but we still have to go through them. And then the Missouri Attorney General's office is the one who handles that, and they decide if the criminal charges are to be filed or not. How to prevent, here's an accident that I wanted to put in there and show that, you know, if you go ahead of time and fix something that is causing concern, how we can prevent a claim. And I know Mark uses this one sometimes too. This was when I went out and investigated, and the employee was riding on a stand-up walk-on pallet jack. They use them in the warehouse all the time. The jack came to an abrupt stop and threw the employee off. The employee had multiple serious injuries, head injuries, things along that line. And there were prior instances with that pallet jack where it had done the same thing. It had stopped abruptly. He even had a manager driving the jack when it stopped, but he happened to be going a little slower, so the manager didn't get thrown off. The claim ended up being about $197,000 and 577 days of TTD paid because the employer did not prevent that accident by replacing $155.18 part. So for $155.18, they could have repaired that pallet jack when they knew it was faulty and had it fully operational after the part was installed. So in this case, $155.18 part could have prevented a $197,000 claim, lost time, and the loss of a good employee. Just shows that if you solve those problems ahead of time, it really does make a difference in the long run. Unemployment benefits, the employee is disqualified from receiving temporary total disability during period of time in which the claimant applies and receives unemployment compensation. And the reason for that is when you go to get unemployment benefits, you say you're able to work. When you're getting workers' compensation benefits, you say you're not able to work. So are you able to work? Are you not able to work? The problem with it is that the insurance company doesn't know if benefits are applied for. And we saw this some during, you know, the COVID epidemic where people were getting unemployment benefits, but some people had some work comp claims going too. So the other thing that we see this a long time is if a business closes down, people hire or file for unemployment, but some of them may have an active work comp claim going. So the information really only goes to the employer, and the employer must communicate with the carrier to let us know that they're trying to get both. Attorney says, I did consult an attorney and asked an attorney what they thought from the benefits were of an investigation. And the comment from J. Bradley Young was claims are won and lost based on the initial investigation. If you don't write it in an accident report, the chances are, he said, I'll never know that information occurred. So he can't defend the case if he doesn't know what happened. And so what a lot of times by the time a claim or a case gets all the way to legal to the point of moving forward, to settlement, there is some time frame in there. There's a lot of time that's gone in between the accident investigation and the actual time that a file is tried or settled. And in this case, if you don't have it in writing, it's probably not gotten to the attorney. So again, one reason why it's so important to have accident investigations in writing, things that you can go for, look at, pull it up at a later date, know where that information is. He also said there's no such thing as too much information. And I know in this world, some days we think there's too much information, but this you hear directly from attorney. He said there's nothing in this world that means too much information. That's kind of the end of the presentation. I'll see if we have some more questions, but you will get a survey after this presentation. I'm going to give you a few minutes of your day back, hopefully maybe still for lunch, but you get a survey that will pop up right after the presentation, and then you'll get another survey that comes through the mail. We'd appreciate you guys signing that or looking at it, telling us what you want to hear, you know, tell us what you liked, go from there. If you don't like something, say Mark did it, but if you like something, say I did it, I guess. And we do have another webinar that's coming up. You can go out. This one will actually be on there. The first series is out on our webinar at mem-ins.com on our website, the webinar is. And this one will be out there probably sometime next week. So you can share it with other people if you'd like to hear it. The next presentation is August the 18th, and that's Claims Management Series, Advanced Work Comp, Understanding the Settlement Phase, and one of our other FSMs will be presenting that presentation. So any other questions that come in, Mark?
Yeah, Terry, have a few. Let's start with a question from Diana. When should the initial report be completed and turned in?
We would like the initial medical report within 24 hours, or initial report of injury. If you can get it within 24 hours and get it to us, we'd actually like it before that. But what I always tell my accounts is to tell your employees you want that claim reported to you before the end of their shift. And the reason for that, people may not know when they come to work, when they're supposed to be there, but they always know when they get off work. So if you tell them, if in your policy, and again, we've got that accident reporting policy out on our website. If you tell them that they should report a claim before the end of their shift, you have a clear time frame that that claim should be reported to you. And then you need to get it into the insurance company within 24 hours. The law actually says 5 days, and 5 days from the date of notice that it needs to be reported before it's late. 5 days can be a long time though, because you could already have a lost time claim by 5 days. So as soon as you can get it in.
The next question here, and I'm going to put in the chat function my contact info as well with yours, Terry, in case folks want to reach out. I can send, we are going to do follow-up emails, but if anybody has other questions, I can feel free to reach out. Another question that came in from Shannon is, will MEM come out to our work locations and perform an audit and give us direction as to areas we can improve? Will you review our policies and provide feedback?
The answer to that question is yes. We have our safety and risk services staff. You know, all you do is you request, and you can do that through me, and I can get it to Mark, or we can get Mark's information out there too. And a safety and risk service person will come on board. And we can actually, I can help with some of that too. And some of it can be done on site. Some of it can be done just by, emailing us the information, and we'll help you work through it. But we're here to help you. It doesn't matter if you're a client of MEMs or not. Now, from a safety and risk services, they don't typically go out to non-clients, but the field service managers can help you too, even if you're not a client, because the whole purpose here is to keep people safe and not get anybody injured. So any way we can do to help that's kind of our mission.
I've actually had good luck setting up, say, 1 hour webinars with customers just to review some basics, and they'll send their policies over to us and we'll look for those things. So that's exactly. Been working lately. Exactly. Let's see. The next question that we have is, can employers attend doctor's appointments with employees when it's a workers' compensation issue or a work-related injury treatment?
They can. It is up to the employee and the physician if you actually go into the exam room. But I can tell you, a lot of our employees say, sure, they can come into the exam room. If they are comfortable with the person going with them, and they are happy with it, yes. There's no reason why you cannot go to the exam. You are the employer. You're directing the medical evaluation and the medical treatment. So you have the right to go to that appointment. Now, you may not have the right to go into the exam room. And the reason for that is HIPAA regulations and things like that. But I know a lot of my accounts that the employee says, sure, they can come in and not a problem. So absolutely.
And keep in mind, everybody is going to get the audio, the recording of this webinar. Okay, everybody's going to get the recording of this webinar today and the PowerPoint. It'll all be emailed to everybody after it's over. And you can sign up on the website for future webinars. You go to the search bar, type in webinars, it brings it up, and you can sign up for future webinars there.
Right. And so, we have this series. So there's a series of three, but also Mark and Flint, I think you've got a whole lot of series coming up this fall that are some pretty interesting topics too. So yeah, there's going to be some of those this fall.
Yeah, we'll be preparing for Slip Trip Fall this fall for the winter. And then our December webinar is going to be really neat. It's basically preparing for 2022. 20 safety rules that all employers need to have in place for an injury-free 2022. So that's pretty, we're looking forward to that, and we hope everybody joins us. And, also invite your supervisors, invite your employees, invite your mid-level management to attend. Everybody's welcome. If you have an employer that's a friend of the family, or, all employers are invited to our webinars. We discuss best practices that work for every insurance carrier. We do these so all employers and all employees can be safe, right? So
we also can do seminars for your supervisors too. So if we want to do webinars, we're doing a few things out in the field again in group settings, but the webinars seem to be working pretty well. So if you have a supervisor and you have a group and you want to do an hour session on the basics of work comp or accident investigations or safety, we can do those opportunities too. So
Terry, that was actually a question that came in. Do we do this type of training for supervisory staff? And we do. We do. We do. So just get a
hold of us. I have one I'm doing tomorrow for about 40 staff members. So, and a lot of times we can make that pretty centralized to your job. So what you're doing and what your business is. And so I actually, on the one I'm doing tomorrow, I went out in their parking lot, took pictures of their vehicles. So if you see somebody taking pictures of your vehicles before a seminar, it might be one of the MEM staff trying to do that. So
we did have another question come in. How does the 24/7 nurse aid work injury line work, Terry?
Okay. We have a nurse triage program at MEM and it is available 24/7. So if you get an employee injured, they can call in and talk to a nurse. They do need to have the employee and the supervisor available. They can talk to a nurse and they will go through a series of questions. So, you know, depending on what the injury is, those questions are customized to that injury to see if they need immediate care, if they can wait until possibly the next morning, what kind of care do they need at that point in time. And the point of triage is trying to avoid emergency care if you can. But unfortunately, in Missouri, we have a lot of rural areas that don't have medical care beyond 8 to 5 readily available if it's not the emergency room. So sometimes what they can do in triage, they can talk to that employee and say, hey, what's the chance that, you know, you think you can Advil, ice it, wait until in the morning till the urgent care or the local direction of care where you want them to go is available, and they can have that conversation with them. So that is something that's available. It's calling into MEM 1-800-442-0593. And you have access. It will ask you if you want to talk to a nurse, and you have access to that 24/7. I really, really like that program after hours, just to keep that emergency room care down if it's not really necessary.
And just really quickly, I want to make a comment to support what you mentioned about your story with the employee that had the injury in the culvert. And, you know, Flynn and I have talked about this quite a bit about I don't know what we would call this, but a stay on path policy, you know, and your employer had success with that. When we are trying to really work on slip, trip, fall injuries in the winter, slip and trip injuries in the summer, you know, just simply staying on approved walking paths is a big deal. You can see where folks cut through the landscaping, they cut through here and they cut through there and they walk around the building and especially in ice and snow,
because they'll walk right over the ice when there's a clear path.
Yeah, so something like a staying on an approved walkway or stay on path policy is a really big deal. So that's something that we recommend. So we don't have any other questions that have came into the chat function. Your contact info is right here, Terry. I put mine in there. Feel free, everybody that's on the webinar today, feel free to reach out if there are any questions. We do really want to thank you for joining us today. Terry, did you have any other comments that you want to make before we go?
I appreciate your time. I know we took your time during lunch, and so hopefully you get a chance to eat. We'll give you a whole 3 or 4 minutes back. But I do appreciate it. And we did want to stay as focused as we could on schedule so we don't take too much of your time. But we're available. We're here to help. And our purpose is to keep people safe. So anything we can do to help you or manage your claim, we'd be glad to do that.